Hello and welcome to Iridium Rock and Metal Reviews. And today, I've got with me Kent Scriber. How you doing, mate?
Hey, buddy. How are you, Lee?
Yeah, I'm good, mate. It's been a while since you've been on. So we did the Rat Top 10, didn't we?
Yeah, we went round and round with it.
Yeah, we did. And obviously, Kent, if you don't know, has got his own YouTube channel called Scriber Drive. I've been on there as well. And man, I've got to say, and you know what I think of your channel, I think it's great. There's stuff I've learned about Striper that I didn't know. You had Perry Richardson on there and his other half, didn't you, as well, on for an interview, and some other great guests, including me.
You were our number one pick, Lee, and we couldn't get you at first, and so we had to settle for Perry and Shelley, right?
Oh, man, so. yeah. But no, honestly, if anyone, I'll leave the link to the channel, obviously, below this video, but honestly, any Striper fans out there, there's some great videos on there, really good videos, really interesting, some really cool subjects to talk about, some really good questions you chuck to people, you know. I love it. You know, you really go in depth with your stuff. So, you know, it's a cool channel. And like I say, everyone check that out. Make sure you check out Striper Drive. It's you and Rex, isn't it, mate? Rex as well.
Yes, sir. And we learn from the best, Lee, which is you. So Rex and I have, we studied your channel, both of us. You know, we were talking, there's a couple, you and two other people were really engrossed in your programs, and we gleaned a lot on the style and the format and all. And Rex and I talking about Striper Drive, and you know, we're like, "Hey, man, have you seen this guy?" You know, we're texting each other. Have you seen this guy on this channel? He's called Iridium, and sometimes he's in his car, sometimes he's in his house, and he goes in depth. You know, and anyway, so. My hat's off to you, buddy. Rex and I both love your channel, and it was an inspiration for what we're trying to do, you know, for Striper. And again, I mentioned it last time, but kudos to you for your excellent interview with Michael Sweet. That was wonderful. So
thanks, man. Cheers. I'm trying to get Todd Latour now, so wish me luck.
Yep. Good luck, right, buddy. Yeah, he's doing an awesome job with Queensryche.
Yeah, man. He definitely is. And he's a nice guy. He's been messaging me as well. Like, we've been messaging each other back and forth. So it's really cool. Do you know what I mean? He answers straight away, just like Michael Sweet does. So that's a really cool thing. Okay then, mate. So obviously, apart from Striper, you like other bands as well.
Yes, I do.
Obviously, we spoke about Rat. And today, we're going to do TNT. So specifically, the Tony Harnell years. So he's obviously been in and out of the band a little bit, but he's always been the main singer for me. Tell me a little bit about how you got into TNT in the first place, mate, and what they mean to you musically.
Okay. Ironically, I first heard about TNT through Striper. Circa 87, 88, they were, TNT and Loudness were on tour with Striper, and I didn't get to make, I believe that was during the In God We Trust came out in 88. I'm just going to say 88. I saw the band Hurricane with Striper in 86, 87 on To Hell With The Devil. So in 88, I'm going to say TNT and Loudness. Wow. Toured with Striper, and I missed the In God We Trust tour. And can you imagine, though, that tour was Striper, TNT, and Loudness? I mean, you talk about musical excellence in that genre.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah. I digress. To answer your question, you know, Striper was my main go-to band, you know, in the 80s, and they still are, actually. But I was reading an interview with Robert Sweet, and, you know, like, they asked him who you're listening to right now or whatever. And he said something to the effect of, right now I'm really digging TNT. And so that made me curious. And so that put TNT on my radar. And then in 1989, you remember when MTV played good music and played music, period?
Yeah, I was going to say, when they actually played music at all. Yeah, yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. Yeah. So back in 1989, I had MTV on, and all of a sudden, Intuition, the song from TNT, came on. And I saw the video, and it just wowed me. Just this perfect blend of sophisticated, and there's a, sorry, my camera keeps freezing up, but this sophisticated, and that's the operative word, sophisticated pop metal. I classify TNT as pop metal because they ride a very fine line between arena rock and metal. But there's a lot of sophistication to it. And so when I heard Intuition with those introductory, you know, riffs from Ronnie Lattacro, and Tony Harnell soaring stratospheric vocals, I was just floored and wowed. And so I actually bought the tape in 89 at Walmart, back whenever they sold good music. And, you know, when I purchased it, I mean, we're off to the races. And I got to tell you, Lee, in the 80s, for this genre of metal that we are talking about, my two favorite guitarists of that genre are Oz Fox and George Lynch. From a little band called Dokken that you might be aware of.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
So through Stryper, I heard TNT, and, you know, and I also heard of Loudness. And once I bought some of their material, among my favorite guitarists, you can also add Ronnie Lattacro and Akira Takasaki to my list. Just phenomenal guitarists. And dare I say this, but I'm just going to be very honest. For this genre of metal, Tony Harnell is my favorite singer of all time. He is just a vocal powerhouse, and his vocals can be smooth as silk one moment. He's not afraid, and TNT are not afraid to do a ballad, but they do them wonderfully. They're guitar-oriented, most of them, and one moment Tony Harnell's vocals are smooth as silk, and the next minute he's got this grit and snarl to him. And the same applies for Ronnie Lattacro. He has his own voice on guitar. He, like nobody else, he plays these staccato machine gun type riffs. I don't know how to describe it. I wonder, in their liner notes, you know, under the credits, there's this thing with Ronnie. It's called the quarter stepper guitar. I really don't know what that is, but I don't know if that's just his certain style of playing or if there's actually a guitar that's a quarter stepper. But Ronnie has these unbelievable, he's a master at the guitar, and that is his voice. They're just an amazing band.
I mean, it ain't often, mate, that you get... I'll tell you what, it's been really strange because I've always thought they were a great band. But I've obviously been listening to all their tracks, trying to get a top 10 together. And I was blown away even recently, even more than I was back then, because you're listening more intently and then you're listening to the solos more because you're thinking, right, we're going to be talking about this. And I was absolutely amazed at some of them guitar solos, even more than I was back then. I suppose when you're younger in the 80s, you know, way back then, you think, oh, that's great. That sounds good. But yeah. Now when you're older and we're doing stuff like we're doing and we're analyzing, I was blown away again and thinking that guitarist is absolutely amazing. And of course, Tony Harnell, absolutely brilliant. Absolutely brilliant singer. So, I mean, we're going to break down our favorite tracks and we're going to talk about them a little bit more. But I mean, I got into them a bit later. Tell No Tales, so that's when I first heard them, 1987. I didn't hear the debut album. But like a lot of bands, I left them behind after Intuition, actually. And then I went back at a later stage and listened to the rest of the stuff. So we've tackling the Tony Harnell years because that's what we like. So, you know, people probably say you should be doing a proper ranking. Well, I've heard some of the stuff, especially the newer singer, and it's not so much the singing even. I'm not too much on the direction of the band now. It's more the direction of the music. It's changed quite a bit. It's no way is what it was. I actually loved Tony Mills. He sadly passed away now. But he's a great singer, and he can almost match Tony Harnell with his range. I used to sing for a great band called Shy. They were a brilliant band as well, British band. AOR, probably not as heavy as TNT, but they're a great band as well. But it's funny, Tony Mills and TNT wasn't brilliant together. It's just one of those things, I suppose. He's actually the perfect match, but, you know, just their record output wasn't as good.
On that note, Lee, and you know, may Tony Mills rest in peace. And I knew that he had passed, and I was very saddened. In retrospect, let me put it to you this way. That combination between Tony Harnell and Ronnie LaTecro, to me, it's kind of like a Page and Plant, you know, or a Tyler and Perry, you know, Steven Tyler, Joe Perry. It's one of those team-ups. It's almost hard. In my mind's eye, it's like, you know, they belong together. And so that impeded my desire to go listen to TNT's music with Tony Mills. And that is my loss, because in retrospect now, having kind of gone back and given it a listen, you know, I mean, I like a lot of what I'm hearing. It's just that TNT to me, you know, it's like Led Zeppelin. You got to have Page and Plant and the other guys too, you know, but there's just some staples that make a band what it is. And so that was kind of that's just my angle, I guess, with sticking with the Tony Harnell years as far as the material.
Well, I was happy with doing that angle, mate, because I haven't really listened to that intently. You know, I've listened to some of it, especially the newer stuff, and I wasn't keen at all. The Tony Mills stuff wasn't too bad. It was a bit up and down, but you know, we're going to tackle the Tony Harnell years because that's what we like. So there's nothing wrong with that, mate. So
that's right.
So just a quick TNT, Norwegian band, formed in 1982. They've actually had 13 studio albums out, but we're going to talk about 8 of them. You know, our tracks, if you like, are from 8. Oh, some of them will be, some of them might not be. That's down to you, mate. But we it's been 8 with Tony Harnell. And he came and went. His biggest, he was with them from 82 to 93, then 96 to 2007. This is all off Wiki, by the way, so you know. 2013 till 2015, then left again, then went back for another year in 2016, 2017. But them later years, not a lot of output from him. The last album was in 2005, actually, with Tony Harnell in. Oh, that was I didn't even hardly take a breath there, mate. That was so I mean, look, this is, as we always point out, this is our favorite songs. This is nothing to do with their hits. This is nothing to do with the most successful period of the band. This is just what I like, what you like. We don't know each other's lists. We're going to go from 10 to 1, taking turns, if that's all right with you. Are you okay to go first, mate? Do you want to start now, or you got anything else to say before we go for it?
You know, let me very quickly, and then I'll go right into my number 10. I just want to say, you know, I really had to think about TNT, and I just want to say this. TNT, to me, they're a dual-edged sword of polished steel tempered by arena rock with a sharpened blade assuring you that it's metal when you ride that blade between the soft and the sonic, the cut of bombast and balladry is infectious. And TNT has never been a one-dimensional band. With their range of the music that they produce in their albums. And when you realize that, you understand that TNT are absolutely masters of their craft. And so that's where I'm coming from. And with that, I'll launch into my top 10, buddy. Number 10, for me.
One second. I mean, you've got a way with words. This is what I'm saying. This is why I love your channel. You know that, don't you? I mean, I was looking just where I got all my info from, which is probably wrong because it was Wiki, like I just said. They describe them as heavy metal glam. I mean, that's just, I don't know. They should have you writing for, just write your version. That's what should happen. You know, you can go on there and edit it, don't you? You should do that.
But you know, brother, I really did. I had to think about, I mean, why do I like TNT so much? I mean, this is serious business. We're talking about a serious band, you know?
You're right, yeah.
And like you, buddy, I mean, all, you know, TNT's on, you know, they've always been on a regular diet with me since 1989, but why do I like them so much? And it's because they are this sword of tempered steel, this dual-edged blade, and the half of it is, it's polished due to this arena rock flair that they often have. But then there's this razor sharp blade that comes through and it you're like, but wait, this is metal. And to me, they're just amazing and the masters of their craft at what they do.
Yeah.
With that said, and don't kill me, Lee, but number 10 for me off of Knights of the New Thunder is Seven Seas. We are rulers of the ocean. This came out in 1984. Ronnie LaTecra winner kicks this album off with that, with that razor sharp riff, and you know this thing's about to rock. Morty Black, the bassist, he has that galloping bass, and then here comes Tony Harnell, who is actually credited as Tony Hansen on the album. He wanted to have that Norwegian flair to his name, so on this album only, he went by Tony Hansen. But then, you know, complimenting the TNT sound, of course, Tony Harnell's unmistakable vocals. And who can forget that chorus, you know? Of course, I'm about to forget the chorus now that I said who can forget it. We are rulers of the ocean, kings of the seven seas, you know, and it just, you know, floats out there, you know, on that sea of metal. And it's great, you know, great song. My number 10 is Seven Seas.
I mean, I think their first album was, they perfected their sound a little bit later, the next album, didn't they? I think they was more straightforward metal on that, a little bit more. And then they became a bit more melodic, I think.
Yes.
You know, that album you're talking about is a lot of fans' favourite. It's their favourite album from TNT. No, that's good, mate. My number 10 is Too Late, From All the Way to the Sun. So, by the way, we don't know each other's list, so we might clash. We might clash. We probably do it at some point. But I just love this. And like I said, I didn't... Oh, nice. Good. It's good that you're showing them, mate. That's good. So, like I said, I didn't... This was a later album for me. I didn't actually listen to this when it first came out. I only listened to Tell No Tales and Intuition when they first came out. So these are ones that I, in later years, you know, probably as I was in my 30s, I suppose, I started listening to the rest of it. But this song is great, man. It's like it kicks straight in, straight away. The melody's there, as it always is. Like a brilliant galloping riff. I mean, it's in the verses there. Nice but simple, effective chorus. It's very simple for them, that chorus, but it's effective. It's sort of infectious, but it's not the most melodic thing they've done. But it, at the same time, it grabs you just like their other stuff. The solo... I mean, we're just going to repeat ourselves, I think, if we start talking about all the solos, because every one of them is so, like, technical. and inventive. That's what I was thinking. He's so inventive, you know, Ronnie Letecro. And I love the guitar sound. And when he does a guitar solo, you can hear every note. It's right at the forefront. It's not drowning everything out, but it's right there in your face. You can hear. It's almost as you can hear his fingers on the fretboard. It's mental. And it's like he plays the guitar as if his life depends on it. And it's absolutely amazing to listen to. But Too Late is my number 10, mate. That's my number 10.
And you know, Lee, and I love that song too. I absolutely, it has one of my favorite TNT lyrics in there in Too Late when Tony sings, "Reaching for a gun, you're not reaching anyone." And I'm like, I dig that, you know, really, really cool little memorable lyric there. So good choice, buddy.
Cool.
So number nine then with me, you know, I'm just going to say this up front. TNT has not released a single studio album during the Tony Harnell years that I don't like. There is much that I love from every single album during the Tony Harnell years. And they have, to my listening experience, you know, during the mid to late 90s, they released a couple albums whenever new rock and new metal, you know, that word new rock and new metal kind of came into the picture, and grunge was still happening, and alt rock was in full swing in the mid to late 90s. So TNT, with a couple albums, they dipped their toe in the water, kind of experimenting with this new rock slash new metal sound. But what I appreciate about them is that even though they dipped their toe a little bit in that water in the latter 90s, they still retained their organic musical integrity of being a metal band, you know, a pop metal band. And so they experimented with some effects and samples, and they did that on this song from 1996's Firefly album, which is my number nine. It's called Somebody Told You. Tony's vocals are biting in this. They cut right across Ronnie's razor sharp riffs. There's a breakdown in the middle eight. And it, you know, those effects kind of come shining through, and they flirted a little bit with that new rock sound, but man, Somebody Told You is just a biting, snarling song, and it just rocks, and it's my number nine.
Cool. I believe I was reading the other day that that's Tony Harnell's favorite TNT album, apparently.
I think I read that too, now that you mention it.
Yeah, it's definitely that album, and there was a song on it, and I can't remember which one it is. It was a single, and he said it's his favorite. I think it's the second one in. He said it's his favorite song as well from them.
Was it Daisy Jane?
Oh, no. Oh, I can't remember now. Perhaps I'm wrong. But it was that album, though. But he apparently definitely, that's his favorite album. It's not mine, but it's still, you know, like you said, there's good things to be found on all the albums, you know. Okay. My number nine, mate, is a song you've already mentioned before we even started getting into our top 10. That's Intuition. So the title track. Now, some people say that the production on this was a little bit polished. You know, it was a bit too sweet, if you like. Yeah, it's a great album. But I can sort of understand that. But I think on some of these songs where you get that, what, like you said, that pop metal arena stuff, that doesn't affect this, because that's what you want to hear. You want to hear a polished sort of on that really melodic stuff. But I can understand on some of the other stuff that's on the album where it's meant to be really heavy, it sounded a little bit polished, a little bit. I mean, all the bands were getting that polished sound around about that time. It had a huge sound on it. But Intuition was such a melodic song, it didn't affect it. So, sort of, such melody in the riffing on this song. I love the way Tony Harnell was singing over the sort of hung out chords on the verses and stuff. Keyboards are a nice touch on this. They're quite high in the mix, aren't they? Making it even more poppy, if you like. And a solo on here, which I can only describe as Queen-esque, very Queen Brian May. You know, there's a bit of influence from there, from Queen, I believe, that inventiveness that they had all them years before. But Intuition's an amazing song. Absolutely, so catchy. That's my number nine.
Well, that's an excellent choice, buddy. And, you know, thinking about, you know, see, I didn't know any better. My first introduction, of course, was this album, Intuition. So that was my first exposure to TNT. I mean, but, you know, I can understand, and it certainly was poppy, but, man, there was still some, well, you know, it's the sophistication that they have. And it wasn't pop metal, and I don't mean to sound deriding to any other band, but when I say pop metal, to me, I've always thought of the band Poison, you know, and I'm not deriding Poison, but TNT is a lot more sophisticated than Poison. Oh. And so,
yeah,
you know,
definitely.
So, but, I mean, that said, I mean, we've got to think about back in the late 80s, you had Stryper that released In God We Trust in 88, which was certainly a, you know, their poppiest album. And then, you know, you had, you know, I'm a fan of the band Europe. And, you know, they had released Out of This World, which was certainly, certainly pop. You know, that was kind of par for the course during that time.
Definitely.
You know, during 88, 89.
I mean, if you think about that album, though, and I don't really want to get into tracks in case you're choosing them or whatever, or, but this shows you how different they were. That opening track on that album, Caught Between the Tigers, isn't it? What a strange track to start with. Very, I don't know, even like a really odd time signatures, not a straightforward rock song. Really strange album to start with, and that just shows you their inventiveness and they wanted to do something different. But, you know, you might have chose that one, so I don't really want to go into too much detail. Right, okay then, mate.
Well, my
number eight.
Number eight for me, buddy. Again, sticking in the latter 90s, this is from an album called Transistor. And this came out in 99. And the song is Wide Awake. And it bridges the gap between metal and arena rock with that late 90s nu metal flair. And the verses on Wide Awake, they just, you know, with Tony singing them and the instrumentation of the band, they just make that song float during the verses. And then the chorus is so uplifting, ethereal, and powerful. You know, it's the one that goes, we can walk on water if we believe it. We can dance on fire and even breathe it. It's just an uplifting, feel-good song, and I can't help but like it. I mean, it had more hooks in it, you know, than a bass fishing tournament, you know. So, anyway, my number eight, Wide Awake from Transistor.
Cool, mate. Brilliant choice. So, my number eight is a ballad. So, I do love a ballad. So, it's from the Terminal Tales album, and it's Northern Lights. So, I mean, man, this has such a cool vocal at the beginning. Yeah, brilliant album. My first introduction to TNT. A really cool vocal at the beginning. It's very smooth over like keys. And then obviously the vocal throughout is amazing. It's a really haunting, almost haunting atmospheric song. Again, an inventive solo, amazing solo, which comes in and out of the melody sort of thing. And he does that a lot. He has like gaps coming in and out of the melody when he plays a solo. Very, very inventive. Like I said, it was hard with the ballads as well, because I mean, I might have some more on here as well, but they are great at a ballad, man, aren't they? And what ones do you choose? It's some great ones, but Northern Lights is my, I suppose it's the one I listen to less, so it seems more fresher to me as well. But a great song, man. That's my number eight. Northern Lights.
Good pick, buddy. Good pick from a good album. Man, this list, you know, this was one of the hardest lists I've ever made, Lee. So I know you and I were talking about doing this episode since November of last year, and I'm actually glad we had more time because, man, this was tough, you know. So my number seven then. Oh, and I'd also like to say that my list is going to lean heavily on a couple of albums, and it's just by happenstance that it did. And it's kind of like you and Paul were talking about on your Michael Sweet episode. You know, sometimes you think certain songs are going to win over other songs, and then by the time you get done, you're kind of like, wait a second, do I need to recount? Have I done this right? You know, but anyway, by happenstance, some of my songs lean to a couple of albums, and that's just the way it is. So you mentioned this. My number seven is Caught Between the Tigers from Intuition in 89. Man, Lee, this song, when I first purchased this album, of course, you know, it began with A Nation Free, which was like this intro into Caught Between the Tigers. And once Caught Between the Tigers kicked off, I mean, it hooked me from the get-go. I knew I'd found a new favorite band because here is this atypical walking down guitar riff from Ronnie LaTakro. And I'm like, what is this? I've never heard anything of that nature, that style before, so atypical. And then once Tony Harnell fired up, I mean, he's got on this song Caught Between the Tigers, his vocals, he's just snarling, you know, in the verses, and it's got that big chorus, and it's just an atypical song. And I loved it, and it made me a fan, and here we are today in 2021.
I almost dare to say it's almost a little bit progressive, that song. It's, you know, it's the beat's a little bit strange, especially at the beginning. And yeah, it took me by surprise because I think Tell No Tales was a lot more sort of straightforward. And then when I first heard, yeah, you're right, A Nation Free, I forgot about that little intro at the beginning. And then when it went into Caught Between the Tigers, the first time I heard it, it took me back a bit. I was like, oh, what's going on here? It sounded a lot different. But no, great choice, man. A really great choice. Okay. My number seven is off of Realized Fantasies. A brilliant album. Underrated, I think, because I think that the album before probably... I think Intuition sort of blew up, didn't it? And I remember one took a little bit of a... In the press, but you shouldn't take notice, said it was a bit of a letdown. No, I don't think that. I think it's a great album. And the track I've chosen is Hard to Say Goodbye. So the riff at the beginning, and when I first heard it, is a little bit similar to another song of theirs, 10,000 Lovers, from Tell No Tales. So, but it's more of a straightforward sort of rocker, this one. Unbelievable vocal delivery in the chorus. It's just mad. And again, the solo kicks in, and it's again Ronnie LaTakro doing these gaps like that he leaves. You know, usually like these guitarists that are meant to be the best in the world, you just see them like going mad over a guitar solo. They'd be, you know, playing it as fast as they can, but he'd do something really fast, but for a few seconds, then he'd do something a bit different. Man, it's one of the best solos I've ever heard on that song. You know, and he's just unbelievable. But that's my number seven, mate. Hard to Say Goodbye.
And that's a really good album. And I think, you know, Realized Fantasies always eluded me. That was the, among this collection of the Tony Harnell years, that was the last album that I picked up. And I've had it for a few years now, but man, I just couldn't find it. I think it went out of print. It was the only album they released on Atlantic Records. But anyway, yeah, it's a good album. And to me, it wasn't a letdown either. You know, it came out in 92. And
difficult as well then, isn't it?
But, yeah, anyway, very good album. So moving right along, buddy, my number six is also from the Intuition album, and it's the title track, Intuition.
Nice.
I had mentioned, of course, when I first heard it, and you know, Lee, I do believe that TNT has surpassed this great song called Intuition. But that said, this is the song that when I think of TNT, Intuition automatically, it's synonymous with the band name. It's my mind automatically reverts to the song Intuition because it was so catchy. And, you know, another example, when I think of Dokken, my mind automatically goes to the song In My Dreams.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah.
You know, so that's an example. I believe TNT has surpassed Intuition as far as greatness, but this is the song that my mind automatically goes to, and I love the song. It's the one that made me a fan from square one when I first heard it on MTV, back when MTV did people a service by showing good bands. Catchy riff at the onset, perfect blend of that sophisticated power pop metal.
Definitely, mate. A great choice by both of us there, mate. I thought that might make your list. I really did. I thought that might make your list. But okay, that's cool. So number six, I've actually mentioned this in the last song, and I had to put it in, and it's 10,000 Lovers. So 10,000 Lovers. Like I said, a sort of a similar riff to the one before, Hard to Say Goodbye. I love this. I think it was a single as well, this one. I love the clean guitar. It's got like a clean guitar in the verses with the vocals on this one. Again, such a catchy chorus. I mean, a huge chorus that just gets you. As soon as you hear it, you'll be singing it immediately the first time you've heard it. Unbelievable vocals again. And I know we're repeating ourselves, but you've got to say it. Masterful performance. And the guitar solo again, I probably don't even have to say that anymore. I think every one of these guitar solos and every one of these vocals is just something special, you know, a real cool band. And I know I probably sound like repeating myself on this channel that, you know, they're one of my favorite bands because I've got so many, I suppose, but it ain't often that you get like I said before, a vocalist and a guitarist as good as this in the same band together. They really hit the jackpot, didn't they? Amazing, absolutely amazing. They probably deserve a lot more than what they've got. I mean, I was reading, I think they've sold something like 6.5 million copies up to a couple of years ago. That's how many albums they've sold. You know, I think they deserve more than that, you know. But
me too. You know, I have a theory about that, and I was actually wanting to discuss that really quick, you know, at some point here, but while we're here, you know, their popularity, like you're saying, it's like for as brilliant as Ronnie LaTakra was as a guitarist and you know, Diesel Dahl and Morty Black on their respective instruments, they weren't any slouches either. And then you have this, I mean, who can match the vocal acrobatics of Tony Harnell? You know, Michael Sweet, he's right there with them, you know. But Tony Harnell is just superb as far as smooth as silk one moment and gritty and snarling the next. And I don't know, Lee, if it was because of maybe the band being from Norway.
Maybe.
But you see, Tony Harnell is American. So, you know, like, I'm a big Loudness fan, you know, but Minoru Niihara, the lead singer for Loudness, he does a great job. But Loudness was a superb band. But, you know, Minoru's accent still really, you know, comes through, and I appreciate it, but I can understand there being a little bit of maybe that being an acquired taste to the palate for some here in America. But Tony Harnell has, you know, he's, he's American. I don't know if it was because the band was from Norway that, you know, that their popularity wasn't more here as it should have been in the States, or, you know, TNT's music, they sing about all kinds of things under the sun, including relationships, but, you know, the old phrase, you know, sex sells. They were never that band that really went there as far as locker room humor. They always had a lot of taste to their music, whether it's the musicianship or the lyrical content. They, you know, they were totally legit, and they just didn't have a lot of the locker room humor cliches in their songs. And I don't know if maybe that didn't, you know, you know, come up, you know, because I don't know.
But that's probably why, I mean, they've actually sold 4.5 million. I went 2 million too much, so it's even less. But perhaps that's why they're appreciated now, though. A lot of these, like you said, them bands that did use that sort of locker room humor, and you know, they're not, a lot of them ain't around anymore. So bands like these are appreciated more now. But I think, you know, there might be singers that reached as good as Tony Harnell, but they only did it for a short period of time. I mean, look at Skid Row, Sebastian Bach, whatever. Mm-hmm. Done it for a couple of albums, didn't he? But, you know, after that, he's nowhere near Tony Harnell. Tony Harnell still got a great voice. So, you know, it's, I don't know.
Well, you know, and I don't know any of these guys personally, but you look at Tony Harnell, you consider Michael Sweet and Todd LaTorre. I have a feeling that all three of those guys took care of themselves health-wise and avoided a lot of the excessive trappings that, you know, might have been around when they, especially when they were younger. And so that's why they can still do what they do. All three of those guys are just superb vocalists. And I feel like they've took care of themselves, and so they can still deliver in spades, you know. That sure, said, man. Buddy, let's talk about a song that delivers in spades here. My number five, again, Forever Shine On. Man, that song floored me. There are so many twists, turns, and atypical riffs within Forever Shine On. And you said something earlier, Lee. There is a progressive quality to a lot of TNT songs, and it's definitely in Forever Shine On. And extremely powerful chorus. There's a bass breakdown that Morty Black does that comes out of left field, adds to that progressiveness. Friends out there, whomever might be watching Lee's channel here, I know it's many of you. If you're not a TNT fan, listen to this song, Forever Shine On.
Great choice, mate. Absolutely amazing choice. Brilliant. Love that song. Absolutely love it. Okay, my number five. Listen, to tell you the truth, a lot of my songs, there's a few albums I haven't touched upon as well, which you'll know by the end. There's a few albums I didn't touch at all. So the next one I have already, though, it's off of Realized Fantasies again. And it's a song called Rain. So, man, yet again, kicks off straight away. You're totally pulled into the melody immediately. Right at the beginning, you're pulled into the melody. Slightly odd time signatures again in the verses. So we're looking at that slightly progressive, not too much where it takes you. And we're not talking Dream Theater, are we? But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking slight little bits they do that are clever, but the melody's there all the time. You know, this maybe has the best vocals. I mean, the pre-chorus on this, you said about Tony Harnell when he goes into his more aggressive approach, if you like, he screams on this pre-chorus. If I did that once, I would probably lose my voice for the rest of the night. Do you know what I mean? It's just amazing. And one of the catchiest choruses they've ever wrote, like a summer song, this one. It's top down, you know, in the summer, this one.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely amazing song. Rain, mate, off of Realized Fantasies.
Man, I don't think there could be a bad choice really with anything from this catalog, you know. All right, buddy, just moving right along then. My favorite track off of 2005's All the Way to the Sun, Me and I. It's my favorite of, you know, this was the last album with Tony Harnell with TNT. And it's so neat, the perspective that the lyrical, it's lyrically introspective, and Tony Harnell is having a conversation with himself about himself. You know, hence the title, Me and I. He's like, you know, he's like, we disagree on many things, and he's talking to himself about himself. Soaring chorus, riding that fine line between arena rock and metal. It kind of begins with an orchestrated introduction prior to the razor sharp riffs just kicking in there. So excellent song, Me and I love it.
Great, man. That was a great album as well. And I'm really glad they sort of went back, didn't they, to their original 80s sound. I'm glad they done that. You know, I don't know if Tony Arnell will ever go back to TNT. Probably not, but I'm glad that he left with that album. It was a great album. You know what I mean? So that's good, man. Okay. My next one is off of My Religion. So nice. And this song is Lonely Nights. So love the chorus again. I know it's becoming a bit repetitive. Almost a sad sort of melancholy sort of feel to this song. Very catchy, but sort of sad at the same time. And almost another Queen-esque Brian May type solo going on. Just a really catchy AOR song, like with an outstanding chorus. You know, everything you expect from a TNT to be so catchy and great, because that was one of the later albums as well, wasn't it? My Religion. It was one of the later albums from Tony Harnell being in the band, and brilliant album yet again. Lonely Nights, mate, my number four.
Superb choice. So my number three off of My Religion came out in 2004, as we mentioned. The song is Satellite. And I think it was first, on their Essential Collection that they'd released. But when I heard this song, you know, I first heard it off of My Religion. It is so upbeat and frenetic, and it's driving power pop metal, and it's one of the few metal songs, power pop metal. It makes me want to dance. I mean, it's got such a groove, you can dance to it, but it's rocking your socks off.
Yeah.
I've never heard a song like it as far as the delivery of this metal song, you know, and absolutely love it. Satellite's my number three off of My Religion.
Cool, mate. That's brilliant. So this next one, mate, is the first song I've ever heard of TNT. So it's off of Tell No Tales, and it's the opening track, Everyone's a Star. Everyone's a star. Man, this just is, it's really heavy and, oh, brilliant. What a brilliant album. I remember having it on vinyl, not anymore though, but I remember when I first heard this and I just thought it was something completely different. It's heavy, but really, like I said all along, really melodic. And I think this is where they was at their heaviest, where they didn't go full fast. They've had some fast songs, you know, in their catalog. And I think a lot of bands, including TNT, lose their heaviness when it comes to fast songs. Some bands could do fast songs and it still sounds heavy, but I feel that bands get their heaviness from more medium paced sort of songs. And that's what Everyone's a Star is. It's a medium paced sort of rocker. Great for opening an album. I mean, I've been talking a lot. I want to do a show on great album openers, and I don't think we probably have to do about 10 shows, because there's a, you know, this is one of them, and that you would choose as a great opener. This is like the first time I heard his voice, and I probably felt like you did the first time you heard his voice. Mm-hmm. So I didn't hear, like I said, Knights of the New Thunder at all, but I went back and listened to it. But there's a massive improvement, yeah, like in his voice as well. That's my opinion, obviously. This sort of showcases straight away the inventiveness as well as the guitarist, and it just carries on all the way through the album. This is how you want an album to kick off, innit? And say, this is what we're all about. This is what you're going to get. Fell in love with it. I remember reading rave reviews on it, went out and bought it, wasn't disappointed. So everyone's a star, mate. All right.
That's a great, great kickoff song and a very standout cut from that album. No doubt about that.
We're getting serious now.
All right, buddy. Again, My Religion, 2004. You're number four, buddy. Lonely Nights for me is my number two.
Oh, nice.
And what I put about it, once you hear the chorus, it sticks with you. It does not leave. You can't get it out of your head. And the way the music makes me feel about Lonely Nights, it has this wonderful atmosphere to it. To me, it kind of paints a picture of like a night on the town, you know, seeing all the neon lights and you know, just a night out on the town. And it's actually a feel-good vibe, but you mentioned something interesting. Because even though the music makes me feel like I'm out on the town, you use the word melancholy, and you talked about a my camera's really making me mad.
Don't worry.
I'm sorry, buddy. But you use the word melancholy, but you also said there's a sense of sadness to it.
Mm.
And so the funny thing, Lee, is that what I put in here is that the music actually belies the message to the song. And this song, lyrically, it's an anti-drug song. And Tony is singing to a friend, you know, say goodbye to the light and watch it fade as you try to hold the rain. Elsewhere it says, say hello to the demons in your mind. And he's talking about this friend having a monkey on their back. And, you know, it's a song about somebody succumbing to drugs. And that's where that sadness comes in that you picked up on. And anyway, but the lyrics are saying one thing, and the music kind of the way that they do it, the chorus is so catchy. There's this sweeping, scooping solo that Ronnie LaTakro does in it that's just awesome. And, you know, that solo kind of ends at the outro with this staccato flair that he does so well. But my number two is Lonely Nights. It's just so catchy and wonderful.
It's a great choice, mate. It's a great choice. Okay, my number two. I'm going to go a ballad again. And I'm going to go back to an album that I think I've gone two or three times to now. Realized Fantasies. And it's Lionheart.
Yeah.
Man, this is just, it's just an amazing, an absolutely amazing song. So I said to you at the time, I didn't go past Intuition at the time. So it was a long time after I picked up this album, years later. But this song instantly became the standout track to me. I heard it and thought, that is so, it's so sort of catchy in a not in a way that a catchy song just is so over catchy. Do you know what I mean? It's too sugary from the beginning. This had hidden melody in it that just stayed with me. Chorus just pulls you in. Very understated song, very subtle, but absolutely brilliant. So much feeling in the solo. Yet again, a brilliant solo, a lot of feeling in it. You can really feel it from Ronnie LaTakro. Almost an epic ballad, very epic sounding. Lionheart is a absolutely amazing song. That's my number two, mate.
And I perfectly understand, because that hook is so big in the chorus of that song. You know, that's what drew me to that song.
Yeah.
You know, the calling card for that one. All right, buddy. My big number one here.
Ooh. I reckon it's going to be the same one, you know.
So I hate to do this, but once again, off of 2004, My Religion, the song She Needs Me. Just a masterwork of guitar and melody, another unforgettable song, writing that cutting edge of arena rock and metal. It has such a grooving, chugging riff that Ronnie lays down, sweeping solo at the onset during the solo, and then these upward runs that he does. I don't know how else to say it. It is just the penultimate feel-good song. And I just fell in love with it from the moment I heard it, and makes me want to be with my wife.
Nice. No, that's good, man.
Just a killer rocking tune. And I realized, you know, I am fully aware of how many great songs have not been in my top 10. But what I did, Lee, is when we were going to do this, it's like I had to go and lay down and close my eyes and say, what songs am I thinking about when I'm thinking of TNT? And the songs that just immediately came to my mind, I had to write them down and then sort them out, you know. But She Needs Me is just a feel-good song, and I just love everything about it. So there, for better or for worse, that's my number one in TNT's catalog.
Well, I thought he was going to be the same as me, but it wasn't. But it's a brilliant song, man. It, absolutely brilliant. And you know what's best about, we spoke at the beginning, didn't we, about what it means to us. So, you know, that makes you feel that way. It's not about what's the most popular song, what was the biggest hit. It's just about what it means to us, and that's great. You know, it's great that you've got something different than me, so that's cool. I've got probably more of an obvious one, maybe a more obvious one, and that's Tonight I'm Falling. So, I mean, man, this typifies everything about the best decade of music, you know, that we had, which was the 80s. There's some good music now, but the 80s was the best for me, personally.
Sure, me too.
So, a perfect melodic rock song, has everything you could possibly want. It's sort of like I'll put down here, a melodic masterpiece that ticks everything a hard rock fan in the 80s would want. A classic. So I've actually mentioned the guitar solo so much on this episode, but this one is another one of those ones where he's using restraint. He's leaving gaps. It's like a song in itself, if you like, the solo. And this is the one where I would say this would blow people's mind. You know, if they've never heard Ronnie the Tech Crow play a guitar, just listen to this. You know, it's just unbelievable. He works his way. I think you've mentioned this, but it's hard to explain. He works his way up the fretboard on this one, but in a really inventive manner. It's not the usual. He sort of works his way. It's a strange sound, but I can't even explain it. And you know what? He's we talked about Eddie Van Halen a lot, haven't we? And his influence and his inventiveness. And I think that this guy has got that, where he's got so much of his own style. There's no one really like him. You got the guy out of White Line, didn't you, that was very inventive? Vito Bratta. Him, Eddie Van Halen, this guy is in those, if not, you know, he's right up there, without a doubt. So, and of course, I can't finish without mentioning Tony Harnell's voice on this. Just, he reaches some heights that are just, man, he's got an unbelievable vocal range. It's unbelievable. Yeah. So there you go, mate. Tonight I'm Falling. And you know, you said about Intuition is the song that comes into your head. I think Tonight I'm Falling is my one, thinking about it. if I'm thinking about TNC, that's my song as well. So that's it, mate. Apart from some maybe honorable mentions, if you've got some.
You bet. You bet. You know, I'm surprised, Lee, that Tonight I'm Falling was your first pick, but yet I'm not surprised because it's like, understandably, that's just such a great song, you know? So I totally get it. I'm just going to run through the catalog really quick and just let you know what I chosen. So, you know, I'm kicking myself for not choosing this one. I definitely have it in my honorable mention. You know, 10,000 Lovers in One from Tell No Tales. I mean, you know, and Everyone's a Star. Both of those songs, there were just some other songs that I guess just resonated a little more with me, but those two were definitely in my my honorable mentions. You know, there was Ready to Leave and Last Summer's Evil from the Knights of the New Thunder album. Those were honorable mentions for me. There's Tonight I'm Falling for You, and there's Learn to Love from the Intuition album. I absolutely love Learn to Love. I had Lionheart and Purple Mountain's Majesty and Easy Street from Realized Fantasies. Easy Street, it's got this piano in there, and it is totally Queen-like in its delivery. I mean, it's so atypical, but that's what makes it so memorable. It's a standout from Realized Fantasies. But yes, Lionheart, I love that song. From 96's Firefly album, there was Firefly. I mean, you want to talk about some atypical chord progressions. When that song kicks off, it kicks butt, and the chord progressions are just so atypical. It's like, what planet is Ronnie LaTakra walking out of by delivering this? But it's so wonderful. There was Angel's Ride from Firefly. There's Daisy Jane with – it's kind of a – I'm going to call it a ballad, and – it's just so hooky, and the chorus from Transistor, No Such Thing, and Because I Love You, and Mousetrap. That's just such a catchy song. And from All the Way to the Sun in 2005, there was Driving that I had. Too Late, as you mentioned, that was in your top 10, I believe, at number 10. Wonderful song. And I really want to say something especially, if I may, in this honorable mention here, Lee. Let's see here. From 2004's My Religion, there was so much I loved on that album. Everybody's Got a Secret was an honorable mention that really stood out. But there's two other songs. Everything You Are and You'll Be There from the My Religion album. You had mentioned something, Lee, in one of your episodes from quite a while back. It was one of your Striper episodes. One of my all-time favorite solos ever, this is something you and I have in common, is from Striper's song Surrender. When Oz Fox does that tremolo in his solo, he just goes off. And I'm going to tell you, when I think of a Striper solo, if we were to ever, you know, if I was ever involved in a greatest Striper solo episode, that is Striper's hallmark solo, and it's Oz Fox who does it, because when I first heard that solo off of Soldiers Under Command, it just smacked me upside my bald head. And, of course, I had a mullet back then. But anyway, You'll Be There and Everything You Are, the two solos that Ronnie LaTakra does in those respective songs, that's like a Striper Surrender moment with me. The guitar wizardry that he displays in those two songs on that fretboard, it's just mind-blowing. And, you know, I so wanted to put those two songs, Everything You Are and You'll Be There, in my top 10, but there were just some other songs that came to mind first that I couldn't let go, but I can't say enough about those songs as honorable mentions. So that's my list, buddy, for honorable mentions.
That's great, man. You know, my first honorable mention is You'll Be There. from My Religion as well. I love that song, man. It was very close. It's very, all these songs were so, I had to battle myself with for not putting them in the top 10. I've got Ready to Fly and All the Way to the Sun, from All the Way to the Sun. From the TN, Tell No Tales album, I've got, and this hurt me and all, leaving this off, As Far as the Eye Can See.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so catchy. This next one, I left it off because I put Northern Lights on there, and I left Child's Play off because I just couldn't have them both because I had so many other songs, and I just thought, which one? And I think Child's Play, I heard it more when I was younger, and I think I chose the one that felt more fresher to me, but very close. Child's Play and Northern Lights are just amazing songs. Desperate Night, what an amazing singing. Tony Harnell in that. Mm-hmm. And the last two I've got is both of Intuition, and it's End of the Line, another slow song, and Learn to Love, which you had. So as you can see, even on my honorable mentions, there's a few albums I didn't even touch. I didn't touch Knights of the New Thunder. I didn't touch Firefly or Transistor. But, you know, not to say they're bad albums. I just think the others, for me, are better, you know, and the songs are better. But, man, it was hard work, that. I don't know why we put ourselves through it.
It was painful, man. I mean, I'm sitting there, Lee, I'm making out my list, and I'm just sitting there wringing my hands. I mean, sweat, you know, it's like,
yeah,
you know, how can I leave off 10,000 Lovers as one, you know, in one? How can I leave that off my list? And, you know, but.
You almost feel guilty, don't you? You feel guilty and you think.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? You feel bad about leaving him off, but you've probably got people going to be watching this and just, you know, everyone's got a different point of view anyway. No one's going to, you know, everyone's going to say, oh, you missed that. But it's just, it's hard. It's really hard when you actually think about doing a 10 for a lot of bands, you know?
And I'll say this, man, as far as I make no apologies for anything on my list because it's all TNT. I mean, it practically all has to be good.
Yeah.
But I'm going to say this, you know, again, you know, not including 10,000 Lovers. And, you know, I should have mentioned As Far as the Eye Can See. I guess I accidentally failed to put that on my list here. I've got a separate sheet of paper for my honorable mentions. But how could I include Somebody Told You from Firefly or Wide Awake from Transistor? Well, I think it's because during the 90s, when all this new rock and new metal were coming from all these new bands, and there was grunge still happening and alternative rock and all that, I was so starved for good music that when TNT released Firefly in 96 and Transistor in 99, I'm listening to those albums, and even though they used a little bit of artistic liberty with some effects and samples by dipping their toe into that pool just a little bit, they still retained that organic musical integrity of who they were as a metal band and that arena rock that they did so well. They even did that well with that little bit of flirting that they did in that area. And it, to me, those two albums were a breath of fresh air in that time. And I could still relate, and you see Ronnie was still laying down those superb solos. And so here me as an old metalhead, I could relate to that and say, yeah, you know, there's some good music here. And I think that's how those songs, you know, came in my list, because I was so thankful to hear those albums during that time.
I'll tell you what, I mean, I don't know if you've heard, you probably have anyway, but I'm not sure if you've heard the other stuff that Tony Harnell's been on. Have you heard the Starbreaker stuff?
I have not. I am aware of that, and he was in a band called Morningwood for a while, pardon the name, but, yeah. You know, I knew he was in some other bands. He even had a stint with Skid Row for a while.
Yeah, that's a shame that didn't work out, because I think he's probably one of the only people that could have done that. But Starbreaker, check them out, mate, because they're probably, quite not. I'm not saying they're TNT, but you would love it. He's right on top form. Three albums out now. One of them only come out like 1 or 2 years ago. So they are brilliant, brilliant albums. I think
I probably should, because him being my favorite vocalist of that genre, and Michael Sweet's right there too.
Yeah.
But it's so tough. It's the same reason why I didn't stick with TNT after Tony Harnell. Yeah. When Tony Mills was there, because I get so together. Torn.
Yeah.
When you love a band and you're seeing, you're right, Lee. I need to give Tony a chance. It's just so hard because it's like, TNT was my band, you know, with Ronnie and Tony, and you know, it's so tough.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. I do agree. Probably the closest album you'll get to TNT from that Starbreaker one is the latest one. I can't remember what it's called, but the newest one. So give that a go. If you like it, you like it, don't you? You know, but yeah. It's not as good as TNT in their heyday, but it's still great. It's still great. So, oh, mate, that's it. Thank you very much for doing this painful exercise with me. We shared the pain, didn't we? We did share the pain, so that's cool.
We did. And it was an honor, Lee.
Yeah.
It was an honor. Thank you for letting me back on. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
No worries. And we're going to be seeing each other on each other's channels anyway. So
yes, we will.
Without a doubt. So thank you very much, mate. So anyone want to put comments? What did everyone think of our list? Do you think we're total idiots, or did you actually agree with most of them? What's your top 10? We'd love to hear, you know, everyone's views on their top 10, whatever, or even if you want to do your favorite TNT song, that'd be cool. Leave your comments below. All right, thanks, and I'll see you next time.
See you, buddy.